Hi everyone, how are you all? I hope everyone is doing good. And I can see. Okay, so that's nice to see all of you. I hope my voice is also pretty clear. If there is any lag or drag, you can always let me know, okay? And I'm sure everybody knows the ground rules, you know. So keep yourself muted. Whenever you feel, you can always ask me for any doubt in the chat window, okay? And keep a pen and paper with you so that you are able to take down your own notes, okay? So all of this is very, very important, okay? Let me see. So that's so nice. I can see Aditi, Ananya, Aritra, Madhumita, Chris, Gurman, Hita. Hita, you're joined from two, you know. Just check if which one of yours is working. Kshitij, Neha, Nitushree, Pradyut, Trisha, Ridhi, Sharvi, Shanmukh, Shreya, Tanishka, Vaibhav, Varsha, Veda, Vidul. Very nice. Good. Okay. So very nice. I welcome you to this session. Let's study well together and have some fun, I'm sure. Okay. Now just for the context, you know, please make sure that you just write in, all your chats do get recorded, and we have people from across schools and even places across the country. So make sure. Yes, Aritra, I've just stopped the screening. So make sure that you make the most of it. Okay. There could be instances when the speed varies depending on your understanding, you know. So some topics could be slow for you. Have patience then. Some topics could be a bit fast. You can always put in a note or a comment in the chat box, and I will make sure that I reiterate that. Okay. This is a 2 hour long session, and you guys are at your home. You know, you might tend to get a bit cozy with things. Okay. I recommend that you keep your NCERT textbook with you. If you have any other notes, also, our class notes, if you are at Centum, if you're not at Centum, elsewhere, please keep your class notes also with you. And I hope everybody knows that we are going to do acids and bases today. Okay. So we'll look at all the possible topics that will be covered. I can assure you that the things that we speak today in these next 2 hours will be an exhaustive list of things that will be coming in the NCERTs, or which we can expect, very strongly. So that's how we make all of these PPTs always. Okay. So yeah, so be with us and keep yourself muted. Most welcome to ask any questions or doubts if you have. Let's begin now. Okay. So the topic that we're going to have today is basically acids and bases, right? Everyone knows acids, bases, and salts, now these are very common household things that we have been using in across our not only foods but also in things that are used in houses everywhere, right? Now, those who were not there last time, okay, I'm going to also show you. Give me a second, I'm going to open up a presenter. Right. One second. Right. So yeah, there we are. Oh, yes, perfect. Now, yeah. So for everyone who has just who were there in the last class and who were also not there, for all of you, this is like a typical distribution of marks from each chapter. Okay, so let's talk about acids and bases. Okay, which is basically denoted here with, let me change the color for a bit. Yeah, we have it here, right? So acids and bases, which is maroon in color. Okay, you can see that this is seven marks have been asked out of this chapter in 2019, and about 3 marks in 2018. Okay, now last time also I told you that these variations keep on happening, and you cannot really predict what chapter would come or would not come in a particular year. Okay, for example, you see sources of energy. This is one chapter where there were 0 questions asked in 2019, but one question came in 2018, right? So relatively significant chapter. Okay. Really get things moved, with this. I mean, if you have done with this chapter, you know, you can expect at least one or two questions definitely to come in. Okay, right. So now, yeah, I think people are still joining in, and therefore we have all of these. Okay. Yes. Now. Yeah. Now let's get to the next. Okay. What is the next, guys? Mute yourselves. Yeah. So you know, we have also seen in the last class what is the going to be the exam pattern this time. Okay, so from all the previous years, you would be the first batch that would go through a different exam pattern. You should expect about 14 marks that you would have from, you know, MCQ, or 40 to 20 questions out of MCQ and very short answer. Very short answer means you either answer in one word or maybe just a few words, not even a sentence. And then there would be directly 3 mark questions and 5 mark questions. Okay, so basically, you know, the total paper being of 30 odd questions, you can expect about 5 3-markers and 3 5-markers. You know, roughly about those many questions. So that's where you'd land up. Okay, with options, of course. I mean, I'm talking about with options. So that's your new pattern that we have. Now let's get deeper into the topic. You know, so we are going to begin understanding the topic. So what is the basic differences between acids and bases? How do we define acids and bases? Now please note, this is one concept which has no more than one definition. It basically has three definitions itself. Okay, now this is very strange, right? I mean, have you ever seen that, having three definitions that needs to be worked out for a single concept, right? Now when it means that there are three definitions, guys, you know, can you yes, you just mute yourself, because if you're joining in late, you know, the things that you're working with, you know, really, yeah. Huh. Okay. Yeah, just mute yourselves, guys. You know, that really helps. Okay. Huh. Yes, fair enough. So this has three definitions, you know, three odd definitions. So the definition that you guys study is called, as you know, its technical name is Arrhenius. Okay, Arrhenius definition. Okay, this is the only one that you study in your textbook. And the definition of acids in this textbook by Arrhenius is one that produces hydrogen ions, whereas bases are those who produce OH minus ions. Okay, so this is the definition. So this line that is given here is the definition of what acids and bases are. Okay, and please note, it is only in aqueous solutions. Okay, so it is very important to have that in aqueous solution. If you're not in aqueous solution, Arrhenius was incapable of defining acids and bases. Okay, now in our general context, as I said, with NCERT, we only cater to things in aqueous solution and not beyond that. Okay? And there are some more you know, properties of acids and bases that we actually look at. Okay. So one of the important ones that we will be looking at is acids is sour in taste, bases is bitter in taste. You know, we know the simple test for acids would be tasting lemon, okay, or testing, for example, acetic acid, okay. So both of this really works. And bases, you know, bitter in taste, you know, one of a good example of tasting bases, guys, you know, if your mic is not working, I might have to simply remove you out of this conversation, you know, because it is just troubling everyone else. Okay, so just make sure that you mute yourself and make sure that your mics are remaining so. Okay, I'll have to set up notifications and make sure that you're muted forever then, you know. So just make sure that, you know, at your end you maintain the hygiene. Okay, let me just figure out whose is that, so I should be able to do something about it. Okay, just try and you know, If you are muting and unmuting, which could also be a loose connection at times, okay, which happens with a couple of laptops. But you know, make sure that you are able to manage yourself rather than me having to really do something about it. Okay, now, right now, these properties. So generally, what are the questions that are asked in these? Is where you need to write the properties of acids and bases. Okay. So having being sour in taste, being bitter in taste, or sometimes even they ask you about differences. Okay, so changes blue litmus to red, red litmus to blue, that also works. You know, they corrode metals, few of them. Now, not all bases corrode metal. Okay, only a few of them do. Okay, especially the ones that are very strong bases, or that are bases that are formed from metals, okay, like Zn, okay, zinc or Zn OH twice. You know, that's a base that is formed from metal. So these all are the ones that actually are, you know, quite in corrosion. NaOH is another one that gets quite in corrosion. And but of course, you know, both of them act as electrolytes. It's not only acids, but even bases act as electrolytes. What do we mean by electrolytes? Something that dissociates, okay? Something that dissociates into individual quantities like A minus and B plus, you know. So AB just dissociates into A minus and B plus. Yeah. Can someone just point out whose mic is that? You know, would really help out. Yeah, you know, so that I can really work on it. Can someone please help me with that? Yeah, so if you are observing any of these, you know, just try and put it out here so that I will be able to work out on it. Okay, yeah. So, right. Now, let's talk about what are the examples. You know, the very common examples are HCl, H2SO4, HNO3, CH3COOH, you know, and a very common example of bases is NaOH, KOH, COOH twice, so on and so forth. Yeah. So both of these are of, okay. Right. Now, so we know all of these examples, right? Now, please note, most of these bases are either formed through a metal, and you would also see that these bases are the ones that, you know, are very strong, pretty strong enough, okay? NH4OH is the one that is slightly weak, okay? So that really, you know, is one that is slightly different. Guys, you know, I, you know, this is, yeah, Arav, can you just mute yourself? Is that Arav or the one that is really, you know, muting and unmuting? Can you please point this out because it's disturbing everyone now? Okay, let me quickly check. I think it is, yeah, it's muted for everyone, but what's happening is someone has a loose connection. What does that do? No, Shitij, it generally happens when people mute and unmute themselves, you know, so that's when it happens. So and it may not be someone's fault, it's just because of a technical glitch, you know. So if you have a loose connection, the muting unmuting actually keeps on happening. And I'm sure Shitij, yes, people also join in, but I don't think so that people are joining and leaving. It's just a technical glitch that's there. But you know, can Shirish, can you please take up this and just check on, you know, yeah, let's Arjun, yeah, good, yeah, just keep an eye and just let me know so that, you know, I can just make him also comfortable because he must also be getting you know, irritated with the same. Okay, yeah, now let's resume on the slideshow. Okay. Yeah, there we are. Okay, now here are some very interesting acids that you can find around in the house. Okay, so of course, you know, what you eat and everything that goes in. HCl is the core component of your stomach acid, whereas all the car batteries and sulfuric acids that we have, you know, is there in the batteries per se. Okay, your car batteries or you know, even in fact, some any large batteries which are used for in inverters, you know, they also would convert, you know, would have sulfuric acid in them. Nitric acid, on the other side, is used in explosives. Okay, so trinitrotoluene, you know, TNT, is a huge explosive, which is basically made with nitric acid, you know, and you'd find that acetic acid, which is vinegar, you know, commonly known, is used in most of the foods. Anything that you use. You know, where you use soya sauce, for example, or there used to be a food product. I don't know if how many of you guys remember it these days. It used to be called as Ajinomoto, you know. So whenever you use these kind of food products, and it was particularly used in enhancing the tastes of you know, some cuisines. So that is all comes from acetic acid. And then you also have, you know, carbonic acid, which is sodas. You know, so all your aerated drinks are basically carbonic acids. Okay. And then you have phosphoric acids, which are flavors, you know. So any flavor that you generally see, you know, whether it is your you know, all of these cold drinks that you drink, you know, and when we add flavors to them, most of the flavors are some combination of phosphoric acid and a substance. So phosphates, they are generally the phosphates of what we use. So So pretty common, these are the ones that you find around in the house. Okay. Some of the most important that you definitely should know, and a direct question can be asked on these, are the ones that are listed here. Okay. So what are those? So one is citric acid. Okay. So citric acid is basically used in oranges and lemons. Okay. I mean they contain that, rather than saying used, we can say they basically are contained in orange, lemons, for sure. And then you have tartaric acid, which is in tamarind. So all of these acids have to be memorized. Okay. They have been asked in past papers, and pretty sure that they can be very well asked. In curd, we have lactic acid. Okay. In milk also we do, especially when milk turns to curd, we end up getting lactic acid. Okay. So that's the one. And in ant sting or nettle sting, we have methanoic acid, which is called as formic acid. The formula for this is HCOOH. Okay. HCOOH, which is methanoic acid or formic acid. Okay. So that's the one that you can actually work with, right? So remember all of these combinations. Okay, pretty useful and pretty important. Okay, to work with. Now, yeah, let's go further. Okay. Right. Now, here are some common bases. Like we saw common acids, now we are trying to see some common bases. So you'll find that NaOH, most of the soaps would have that. Okay, every soap that you've seen in the house is either, especially the ones that we use with soft water. So all bathing soaps, especially bathing soaps, anything that is used for cleaning hair, even the cosmetics that we have, has some form of dilute NaOH in it. Drain cleaners. So, there are very strong drain cleaners that actually are used. So that's also something that you can figure out. Okay. And then you have antacids, something that you have for, avoiding acid refluxes. So when you avoid acid refluxes, you will realize that, antacids is something that you have, MGOH twice. So, particularly, there have been people who have been asking, sir, just Jellocil have antacid? Not very strongly. Of course, Jellocil is an antacid, but not in a very high quantity, but milk of magnesia, for example, is something that is purely made up of MgOH twice. Okay, and then you have aluminium hydroxide, again used in antacids a bit, but commonly used in deodorants as well. Okay, common component of deodorants, and ammonium hydroxide, generally used in any ammonium product, including things from urea to some medicines. Whenever ammonia is being used, in fact, it's commonly, if you go to a shop and if you want to buy this, it's called as ammonia water. Okay, so ammonia water is what is ammonium hydroxide, and there are different concentrations of these ammonium hydroxide that you will find being used across places. Okay, so that's so these are some common bases in household usage, okay, that we have. Now, the first important thing that we actually know about this is we should know about is acids and bases is its classification. Okay, there are a few classifications that have been explicitly mentioned in NCERT. A few have been just fleetingly mentioned. Okay, so for example, based on their origin, so we call them as organic acids and we call them as mineral acids. Okay, the very name itself says something about it, isn't it? So organic acids are ones which are derived from living. So this is a model, these are the keywords. So whatever I'm circling, are the keywords. So please make sure that these words should come in your answers whenever you write an answer. We'll go through a few answers today also. So anyone that is derived from living organisms, which are plants or animals, they are called as organic acids. For example, citric acid, derived from fruits, acetic acid, which is derived from vinegar. Okay, oxalic acid from tomato, tartaric. We have just seen this a few minutes ago. Lactic acid from milk and curd. All of these are derived from what do you say? Living organisms. It's some form of plant and animal. Okay, so that's something that really helps. Okay, now. What are mineral acids? Mineral acids are the ones that actually are derived from inorganic substances. Now, what could these inorganic substances could be? So some of them could be basically just like sulfur, so we have sulfur streams. If you go to Yellowstone National Park, I don't know how many of you have heard of this. In US there is this park. Okay, so you'll find that there are sulfur aquifers, which means there are these hot geysers that come out, which actually deposit a lot of sulfur around it. Okay, now there a lot of acid is formed, H2SO4 acid is formed. It is so strong that it obliterates completely any life, a few meters away from these sources. So just nothing can survive there. In fact, if you go to the depths of ocean, you know, you'll find that there are living organisms which only can live on sulfur, you know, which are anaerobic respiration. You know, they eat sulfur, they give out SO2, like we breathe in O2 and we exhale SO2. They eat up and breathe in sulfur and sulfur compounds, and also you know, give the same thing out, you know. And then there is HCl, for example, completely derived from chlorine glass gas. Okay, what is the most important source of chlorine? Most of it actually comes from NaCl. You know, our seas are filled with NaCl, so a large composition of you know, NaCl will end up making into Cl2. Okay, so that's from the basis of origin. Okay, so that's one. Now let's talk about classification based on strength. So this was based on origin, now based on strength. There are strong bases and weak bases. You know, everybody has known this. Anyone who has studied this chapter even slightly would understand that there are strong bases and weak bases. Okay, so what are the strong bases? Strong bases are those which completely dissociate. Okay, they completely dissociate into ions, which means that you put, let's say, you know, I'm going to take some easy numbers. Let's say you put 100 molecules, okay, of KOH. You'll realize that I would end up getting 100 molecules of K plus, and I would end up getting 100 molecules of OH minus, you know, K plus and OH minus both. So that's how strong bases, or even for that matter, strong acids dissociate. Now, out of 100, let's say only 5 dissociated. That's called as weak acid or weak base. So in these bases, do not completely dissociate. Now, what is the difference? You know, generally nature has made it so interesting that the strong ones would almost dissociate anywhere from 90% to 99%. And the weak ones, you know, there are a few which dissociate about 50 to, let's say, 30 odd percent, but most of them would dissociate less than 10%, very interestingly. Okay, so they have kept a large variation in terms of what are strong and weak. And therefore, even if you have a qualitative definition, you can understand this definition is not quantitative, it's a qualitative definition, which means we are not exactly seeing how much, you know, we are saying completely and not completely. So does 99 dissociation means it is not completely? No, it means it is complete dissociation, almost dissociated. Okay, so nature has made this interesting thing that either they will dissociate up to 90, 99%, or they will dissociate only up to 10% or less than that, you know. So that makes this division very, very clear. Okay, it makes very clear distinction between how strong bases and weak bases react. Okay, now here are a few more ways in which you can actually you know, classify acids and bases. One is based on concentration. So you know, you have, you know, dilute acids and you have concentrated acids. You know, everybody knows what's dilute. Dilute means little acid, okay, little acid and more water. Okay, more water. Okay, what does concentrated mean? High amount of acid, you know, huge amount of acid and less water. You wouldn't say less water, but you would say as compared to water, the amount of acid is high and therefore it is concentrated. And you know, I'm just as a fleetingly, I'm going to give you another you know, definition of these acids and bases, or another you can say a classification of this, which is saturated. Okay, so you have saturated, which means that no single extra amount of acid can be put in. Okay, saturated means now it is filled to the brim, which means if you add some more, like NaCl, you know, you are adding salt. If you add any more salt to it, the salt will not dissolve. That is saturated. Similarly, acids also get saturated, including strong acids. You know, so a lot of people have a misconception, sir, strong acids never get saturated. Wrong. If you put HCl crystals in water, after a certain amount of time, even the HCl crystals will not dissolve. Okay, it will get saturated. So that is the way, that is the point where saturated you know, concentration is reached. And then you have, on the basis of number of hydrogen ions, or for that matter, hydroxy ions given out. Okay, please note, guys, concentrations, like we have decided acids and bases. Similarly, on the concentration, we also have dilute bases and concentrated bases. And then we have on the basis of hydrogen ion and hydroxide ion. So when you have a monoprotic acid, you know, the very word monoprotic means what? Mono means one or single. Protic means hydrogen, H plus. Similarly, you have monoacidic. Now, please note, this is monoprotic and this is monoacidic. Now, you know, this is another point of contention. I want everybody's ears to be here. Okay, very important point. And the point is, bases have acidity. You know, very, very important. Bases do not have basicity. Please note, bases have acidity. What does that mean? How many acids can the base neutralize? How many acids can the base neutralize? So what does it mean? Let's say I take NaOH, KOH. NaOH can fight with only one HCl. KOH can fight with one HCl. So therefore, NaOH and KOH are monoacidic base. Monoacidic base. It is not monobasic. So as bases have acidity. Similarly, when you say a diacidic base like CaOH twice, it means it can fight with twice of HCl. It can fight with twice of HCl. So therefore, CaOH twice is a diacidic base. And therefore, similarly, you can have triacidic and polyacidic also. This is not polyprotic, okay? This is polyacidic. So you can have polyacidic base, okay? Very unknown kind of a base, but just for your information, even if you don't remember, no problem. So there is something called as FeOH5-2-, okay? FeOH5-2-. So you can end up getting 5 OH- on this, right? So this is a pentaacidic base, very, very highly basic, right? So these things exist. But on the other side, so there is no harm in saying that it is monobasic, okay, or dibasic or tribasic, okay? So monoprotic can also be written as monobasic. So acids have basicity, okay? What does it mean? How many bases can an acid react with? How many bases can an acid react with? Okay, bases can an acid react with. Yeah. So these are.
I have a doubt.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, could you give an example for polyacidic again?
Polyacidic base.
Yes.
Okay. So as I said, beyond your context, but a poly, there are multiple of those. So for example, FeOH thrice is the common compound. This actually reacts with additional OH minus to make anything from.
Okay.
Tell me.
Chemical name for FeOH5.
Oh, this is a complex. This is a complex. So it is this is ferric, right? So ferric hexahydroxide. Okay. So this is a complex beyond us. Okay. But just remember that, yeah, there are possibilities. There are possibilities that can happen.
Okay.
Okay. Similarly, there are polyprotic. For example, you have NH4, NH4 plus. This is pretty common, right? So this is tetraprotic or tetrabasic. Please note, this is tetrabasic acid. Tetrabasic acid. Can give 4H plus if required. Can give 4H plus if required. Okay, good. So some interesting stuff here. Yeah, sure. Now let's talk about indicators. Now that we have acids and bases understood pretty well, can we understand how to really recognize them? Okay. So there are these natural things in nature that can help recognize acids and bases. Okay. So they are called as indicators, very simply. So an indicator indicates, right? As simple as that. So they simply indicate. So what are these indicators? There are many of those. There are many of those. One second. Okay. Right. So litmus. Litmus is the most common indicator, okay? And it is something that you can what do you mean by natural indicator? That you don't have to really process it. Okay, you don't have to process it to do anything. You just take the litmus paper, you dip it, and it will show its color. Okay. So it's generally found also in lichens, So it's actually an extract that we take from lichens, which are very sensitive to acids and bases. We will see their colors in just a few minutes. Are there a few indicators that you have? So this is the definition, okay? An indicator indicates the presence of acids and base through colors or through a visible observation. Okay, through an observation is a good sentence. You can just add to it, is through an observation. Okay, observation means something that is very concrete that can help you. So red cabbage is another indicator. Colored petals of petunia or turmeric. Okay, turmeric is another indicator. We also have olfactory indicators, which means something that can be sensed through smell. So they show odor. Okay, they show odor in acidic or basic media. You generally have onion or clove, very strong odor, right? Very strongly, strong presence of acids. In fact, I don't know how many of you have also smelled garlic oil, for example. If there is this garlic oil, it is so strong that if you just take a small, I wouldn't even say a drop. The way that they put DOs on your, on the back of your hand, if you just put a small garlic oil there and if you smell it, you'll find that it actually gives you a like a small prick right inside the head. You know, it is that strong. So try that sometime. You know, so a very strong olfactory indicator can be found in garlic oil, for example. Okay, now this is very, very important. Okay, all of this you need to memorize and remember. Okay, very important slide. Please note, blue litmus, this is very easy. Everyone knows that in acids they change to red. So in acids everything remains red. Please note, red, you know, either it will have no change or it will remain red. So remember, acids is like danger. You know, this is how you can remember it. Acids is like danger, and therefore it is red in color. And if you want something in bases, so in bases you will find that you actually end up going everything to blue. Okay, blue is the color that bases you will find in bases. Okay, so blue here and red here. Now methyl orange, this slight difference, instead of going to blue, it actually stops at yellow. Okay, so methyl orange in bases stop at yellow, in acids it is still red. Okay, and phenolphthalein, instead of again going to red, it stops at pink. So these are the two outliers. So remember, phenolphthalein, which is colorless by choice in by nature in acids, become pink. Achha. Another very important point, people don't have this idea about it. Except for litmus paper, although they also help, all others can be repetitively used, which means if the solution becomes base, you will find yellow, but then if you make the solution again acidic, it will go to red. They can be used multiple times. They are not single use products. But for example, litmus paper, you know, while before going to multiple uses, you know, it will lose its ability to show color change. Okay, now, and this is the universal indicator. Okay, universal indicator. Now please note, universal indicators in the acids are also red, in bases it generally goes to blue. Okay, and if you have to remember this, you know, you have to remember Vibgyor. Okay, so Vibgyor is what, VIB, the rainbow colors, right? GYOR. You can see the universal indicator also follows the same color pattern. You know, as you are strongly acidic, it is red. It starts becoming oranges, you know, at lesser acidities, around pH value 2. So please note, these pH values is not something that you need to remember. No point in remembering these pH values. No, not needed. But what you need to remember is, in acidic, what it is, generally, as you start going towards neutral, you will find that it is green or dark green. Okay, so if you are more towards acid, say green. If you are more towards the neutral side, you say dark green. Okay, and when you start going away from the neutral, okay, which is 7, you know, it starts going to blue. And in fact, you know, your textbook actually says that even at 11, 12, it is dark blue. Dark blue. Kshitij, can you please identify this, the one that is really you know, Kshitij Veda, can you just please make, you know, okay, Veda, Aritra, you know, I would be really happy if you put this to some productive use. You know, why don't you guys just make sure, you know, Veda and Kshitij, can you just please you know, help me identify that, so that I will also be able to help the poor chap, because he'll be hearing half the session and also be putting others to loss. Medha and Nitushri, can you just make sure that you mute yourself, Medha? Yeah, Medha, I know that you have this. Last time also there was an issue with your mic. Okay, yeah, that's Medha. So let me just make sure that I. Okay, thank you for that, Nitushri. Just you know, if you have a loose connection to your end, you know, just make sure that you maintain that. Yeah, that's actually Medha. I can see that now, Medha. You know, can you just, if you're there on the phone or something, you know, can you just make sure that, yeah, much better. Thank you. Okay, great. Let's get back. Okay. Right. So that's a universal indicator for us. Okay. Now we are coming to the chemical properties. Okay. Now, generally, most of the times this question is asked to give you a certain, particular reaction. Okay, so generally they would ask you to say what happens when metals are put in acids, or what happens when metals react with acids. Okay, so you'll realize that when metals react with acid, hydrogen is given out everywhere. Okay, this is a important observation, and a salt is formed. Okay, and a salt is formed. Now, there are many examples that I've given you here. I've given an example of HCl. I'm also given you an example of a very weak acid, which is CH3COOH. Okay, please note, even with CH3COOH, which is a very bulky molecule, zinc does form a zinc salt, which is ZnCH3COO twice. Please note that twice. Zn has not lost its valency of 2 here also, plus 2, plus 2, plus 2 here, you know, ZnNO3 twice. And you find that everywhere hydrogen is given out. Okay, a common question that would be asked is, a metal was put in a solution and it gave a pop test. Okay, what is a pop test? So you generally put a burning candle, or generally the word splinter is also used. Okay, splinter or a candle or a matchstick, you know, anything that is going to give you some fire. Okay, and when this is brought close to the test tube, you know, you will find that a pop sound or an explosive sound, okay, it's basically a small explosive sound is given out. This test confirms that there is hydrogen. Okay, so please note what are the wordings. You know, the when anytime you have these wordings, definitely know that H2 was given out. And if there is a metal that is involved which is giving H2, it has to be acid and also base. And I'm going to come to base in a few moments, and I'll also tell you how to distinguish between acid, whether it is then acid or a base or not. Okay, but this is the reaction of acids with metal. Okay, so what is the reaction? They end up giving you know, salt and hydrogen gas. Okay, now let's talk about next. What does bases do with metal? Now only you know, NaOH and Al, okay, only zinc and aluminium are the two that are mentioned in your textbook. I do not expect any more coming. In the past 10 years it has not come, even now it will not come. Okay, so please make sure that you write this pretty well. Okay, now here the formula is NaAlO2. Please note, this is Na2ZnO2 and this is NaAlO2, also called as aluminate. Okay, sodium aluminate. Okay, that is zincate and this is sodium aluminate. Both of these formula are very important. You write this as 3, you lose your marks. You write this as 2, you lose your marks. You write this as 1, again you lose your marks. So very important. And this also ends up giving pop test. This also ends up giving pop test. So NaOH plus zinc ends up giving sodium zincate and sodium aluminate, and you have your hydrogen gas released, giving you a pop test. Okay, now such reactions are not possible with all the metals. As I said, remember only zinc and aluminium as the example, that too only with NaOH. Okay, so this is the one that is there in your syllabus and will help you. Okay, now let's go to action of acids and bases with metal carbonates and bicarbonates. Okay, what happens when an acid reacts with metal carbonate or bicarbonate? Obviously, whenever a carbonate or bicarbonate is given out, this is the more important vital you know, component. What happens is Na2CO3 plus HCl will end up giving you NaCl, water and CO2. Okay, NaCl, water and CO2. Now how do we know? So we cannot detect NaCl directly, we cannot detect water directly because water is there in the solution all the time, but CO2 can be detected through a test which we will come in a minute. So this reaction is when acids plus anything that contains CO2 will have to release this CO2, which can be very easily detected. Okay, similarly metal bicarbonate plus acid can also end up giving sodium you know, carbon dioxide, salt and water. Okay, so NaCO3 and CO2. Okay, this can also be given out. Okay, now what is the test for? So pop test is for you know, hydrogen. What is the test for lime water? For CO2, the CO2 test is lime water. What does it mean? Please note, there are two tests here. Half of the people only write one test, and I said this in the last time, I said this in the paper explanation also last time. So the first test is whenever CO2 is passed through lime water, which is aqueous CaOH twice, aqueous CaOH twice, lime water. Okay, you will realize that CaCO3, a PPT is formed, which is white in color. So this color is important, PPT is important. Now if we pass excess CO2, this is the second test. So this entire thing is first test and this is the second test. Please note, if CO2 is passed for very long, milkiness disappears and calcium hydrogen carbonate, which is soluble, for example CaCO3 plus H2O plus CO2, you know, if you keep on passing more CO2 in it for a long time, you'll find that sodium bicarbonate or calcium bicarbonate or calcium hydrogen carbonate is formed, which is soluble, you know, so your PPT dissolves. Okay, so both of this should be written. If they have given you one test, that is okay, because you are going to identify the substance, you identify it as CO2. But when you are going to mention that how will you detect CO2, it is mandatory to write both the tests. I will say this one more time. Even if it is a two marker, I have seen these in papers. In two markers, they expect four keywords. Okay, so what they will do, they will say, okay, white PPT is the first, the entire thing as first keyword, insoluble as the second keyword, soluble on excess, that is the third and fourth keyword. So they will, you know, in a simple way, they will give you these four, and if you don't write all of those four, you end up losing marks. So that's an important aspect of chemical properties of acids and bases, lime water test, of CO2. Now, the third reaction, which is common for both acids and bases, obviously, is the neutralization reaction, which is base plus acid end up giving you salt and water. So NaOH plus HCl gives salt plus water. The neutralization reaction, when the effect of base, or for that matter, effect of acid is nullified by the base or vice versa, to give salt and water. So this is a very, I'm not going to spend much time on this. You know, everybody knows this reaction pretty well. Okay. What I could do is I could, you know, what is one important thing that could be challenging here is sometimes, not challenging, I would say, but that you have to definitely remember, which I've spoken about in chemical reactions and equations, is write the state and balance. If you don't write the state and balance, you end up losing marks. A typical example given is what happens when something like BaOH twice reacts with, let's say, unlikely, but giving you an extreme example, CH3COOH. Okay, what happens? So you would say, CH3COO twice barium. Okay, so this is barium acetate. If you write it barium at the beginning, no problem. Okay, don't think that it only has to be written at the end. No, nothing like that. You know, you can write at the beginning, it doesn't go wrong. This is barium acetate plus water, and then you have to balance it. There will be two in here, and there will be two in here. Okay, so the balancing is required. This is aqueous, this is aqueous. Okay, this is also aqueous, and this is liquid. Okay, don't try this as aqueous, this is liquid. So the balancing and state is something that is important, else you tend to lose your marks. Okay, now chemical properties of acids and bases. This is reactions of metal oxides. Now, for everyone who either have studied with me or not otherwise, please note, all metals, use the word almost, okay, almost all metals, all metal oxides and all metal hydroxides are basic in nature. Please remember, all metals, metal oxide, metal hydroxide. Let me give you an example, potassium. So potassium is basic, potassium oxide is basic, potassium hydroxide is basic. Let's talk about sodium. Sodium is basic. Sodium hydroxide is basic. Sodium oxide is basic. Sodium hydroxide is also basic. And exactly the reverse for non-metals. Exactly the reverse for non-metals. So all non-metals, non-metal oxides and non-metal hydroxides are acidic in nature. Let me give you an example. Let's take N, nitrogen itself. So nitrogen is acidic. You know, N2 is acidic. It's inert in more ways, but if it reacts, it will react like an acid. NO2, okay, or simply NO, or N2O3, any of those, they are all acidic. They are the ones which form HNO3. Okay, they are the ones which form HNO3. Then NOH, you know, H3PO3, for example, HNO3 is also nothing but NO2OH. Please note, this is nothing but HNO3. It can also be written as NO2OH. This seems to be like an hydroxide with an OH, but it is an acid. Everybody knows HNO3 is an acid. Okay. Similarly, H3PO3 can also be written as POH thrice. Doesn't mean that, you know, it is a base. It is still H3PO3 and it is quite an acid. It's quite an acid. So all non-metals, most non-metals, non-metal oxide and non-metal hydroxides are acidic in nature. And then there are some which are in the fringe, which lie in between these two. They are amphoteric. Okay, two classic examples that I can always give you is ZnO or ZnOH twice. Okay, another very classic example that I can give you is aluminium, AlOH thrice. Both are amphoteric. What do you mean by amphoteric? Sometimes they will show acidic, sometimes they will show basic. You know, I on either sides, neither here, neither there completely. Acidic and basic both. Okay, so now whenever metal oxides are going to react, very remote chance of reacting with base. Not possible. Why? Because they themselves are basic. We just studied, right? Metals, metal oxide, and metal hydroxides are basic, so they will react easily with acids. Only these two are the ones which will react with base. And we just saw a few minutes ago that they form sodium aluminate and sodium zincate respectively. I have already said this a few minutes ago. Okay, right. Now coming back. So you know, take a note of this. I hope everybody is taking down these key important points. You know, some thumb rules that you will always remember and will help you in any time in the exam. Okay. Now, if you know this, then what is the important point? That you take any metal oxide like CuO, put it in HCl, you will end up getting copper chloride plus water. Okay. So base, this is basically a base plus an acid, ends up giving you salt plus water, same reaction. Now, this appearance of blue green color, these colors are also another important point of the solution. So this will be your blue green, okay, which is your CuCl2, is because of the formation of CuCl2, you know. So so I've already told you this point, right? So this is another important metal oxide reactions of acids. You can also expect that they will end up giving you metal hydroxides, okay, which anyways you know most of them would be basic. Yeah, here's an example. CaOH twice, metal hydroxide reacting with a you know, with an acid. Okay, so this is non-metallic oxide. This is a wrong example. Okay, I'm sorry. I don't know how this popped in here. So this is nothing but this is a metal hydroxide. Okay, this is a metal hydroxide reacting with an acid. CO2 is an acid here. Please note, it is a non-metal oxide. Oh, okay. Hey, this is the right example. But what they have done is they have simply flipped it. So non-metal oxide is this actually. You know, CO2 is a non-metal oxide, and this is the base. So they have flipped it in some ways. So it should all actually be written as CO2 plus CaOH twice. Okay, so this is your base, and this is your non-metal oxide. Okay, so this is a non-metal oxide. Now we have just seen a few minutes ago, non-metal oxides are acidic in nature. This is a base, ends up giving you salt. Okay, ends up giving you salt, which is nothing but CaCO3 plus water. Okay, which is nothing but H2O. Okay, so non-metal oxides are said to be acidic in nature because on reacting with the base, they produce salt and water. Okay, so this is your non-metal oxide plus base. Now we want to talk about strengths of acids and bases. So a few minutes ago we spoke about strengths of acids and bases, where we did a qualitative definition. Even here we will have this definition as qualitative only. We are not going to go to a very quantitative definition per se, you know, in terms of strength. But you know, there is some indication, you know, you can go close to defining how strong or how weak it is. You know, you're just going to estimate how strong or weak is that happening. Okay, now, so the strengths of acids and bases, they basically depend on H plus ions and OH minus ions. You know, that's how they work with. Okay. Now, so there are multiple ways. Of course, with universal indicator, you get a very good idea as to how strong or how weak that acid is. You know, I just told you, remember red for acids, blue for bases, green for neutral. Then you can do two more things on it. You can put orange, you can put light green, dark green, light blue and dark blue. You know, you can bring in so many variations in it and cover your pH pretty well. Okay, now so whenever this universal indicator is used, you get a relative idea of how strong or how weak it is. Okay, but there is a more definite indicator, which is the pH scale. So this pH word comes from potenz, you know, which basically means power in German. Okay, so in German Deutsch, you know, Deutsch language, it means power. Okay, so power of hydrogen, that is what we really work with. Okay, now this scale is generally from a 0 to 14. Now this is very mysterious. No, it is not 10, it is not 5, it is not 8 octate, it's 14. You know, and you know, just to give you an idea about this, is because in nature it was found that H plus into OH minus concentration in water is always equal to 10 to the power minus 14. This is found in nature. Okay, so and therefore this 14 comes in. So this is like another constant, like pi. You know, 3.1425, you know, to whatever, you know, that long pi value is. Similarly, 10 to the power minus 14 is a constant found in nature, which was the multiplication of the concentrations of H plus and OH minus, generally called as ionic product of water. Again, beyond our syllabus, but for your, you know, to have you a small amount of curiosity on this. If you exactly have them same, right? You have, if you have H plus and OH minus same, what will happen? This will be H plus square, you know, H plus concentration, the whole square to the power 10 to the power minus 14. So H plus will turn out to be 10 to the power minus 7. And therefore, whenever 7 comes in, you end up getting neutral very easily. So whenever you get your pH value as 7, you will have neutral value. Okay, guys, I might not be able to read your comments right now, but you know, you're free to open up your mics and ask, like someone did recently, you know. So completely okay. If you have put any comments at the end of the session, I would definitely go through them. Okay, so yeah, so that's one, right? So you neutral is 7, alkaline is so remember, pH is like a rank. Higher the rank, more the acidic. pH is like a rank. Higher the rank, which means if you are ranked 1, then you are very, very acidic. Okay, so you are very powerful and very acidic. Now there is also something called as a pH paper. Okay, it actually also is very close to universal indicator with small synthetic additions to it, and you can actually measure pH out of this. Okay, you are able to measure the value of exact value of pH from here. Okay, now let's talk about the strengths of acids and bases. You know, so when you have pH values of 0 to where your pH paper value, so your color of pH paper would be about dark red. You know, we just saw this, your universal indicator color is also dark red, right? The solution is highly acidic. You know, H plus ion concentration will be very high and OH minus will be very low. If you're somewhere around 4, you know, generally about orange to yellow color, you are just acidic. You know, from 0 to 4, you are just acidic, you know, moderately acidic, you can say. H plus ion concentration is high and OH minus would definitely be low. Please note, OH minus concentrations still are present. Does not mean that OH minus are not present in the solution at all. It simply means that H plus are much, much larger than OH minus, like a million times larger, like a, you know, million at times larger. Okay, so that's the concentration equivalent. When you're at 7, you know, the value is generally about green, and you'll find that the H plus and OH minus values are just the same. You know, it's just the same, they are equal, you know. And then you can go just the opposite, right? So at 10, you will find that bluish green or blue, and at 14, you'll find dark blue or violet, like Vibhyor, right? We spoke about it, violet to about red, Vibhyor. Now, highly basic, very low, very acidic. And here are some examples, HCl, H2SO4. Now, you know, someone asked me lately, sir, what is H2SO3? H2SO3 is a weak acid. Please note, it is not a strong acid. H2SO3 would be categorized under weak acids. So H2CO3, H2SO3, even, you know, phosphorus acids are all weak ones. Now, what are the strong bases? NaOH, KOH, CaOH twice. What are weak ones? NH4OH. Okay, NH4OH is the good example of a weak base. Right, now let's go further. Yeah, now why are we studying this pH? You know, what's the role of, you know, why pH, right? So it is very important in our daily lives also. And there is this question that directly comes, you know, state the importance of pH in your daily lives. And then it's generally a 3 marker. You generally have to give up to 5 points. There are many points that I've mentioned in here. For one, it is very important for our digestive system. You know, our pH in our digestive system is regulated to digest the food. Similarly, it is also regulated in our blood, you know, for that matter. Okay, that's also very important. Our blood is, you know, slightly alkaline, you know, generally about 7.1, you know, 7.1, 7.2 max. Okay, slightly alkaline. So very close to neutral, but alkaline. Yeah. Then, of course, you know, and then there is acid reflux that you can speak about in for bodily points. You know, you can speak about antacids. That's also something that is important in pH. So if we know pH, we are able to figure out all of these values. You know, we are able to treat the pain and irritation in our stomach because we understand pH. Okay, so antacids, I've already mentioned it here. So these antacids neutralize the excess acid and we get relief. Then you can also speak about acid rain. Okay, so acid rain is generally as a, you know, pH less than 5.6, you know, generally called as acid rain. In fact, you know, this question was asked in the IITs. I've mentioned it in few of my classes. Just last year, it was asked in the IIT that what is the pH of the acid rain? Can you imagine your syllabus question asked directly in 12th grade? And very few were able to actually give it a right value. You know, this value was asked last year. Now, when acid rain flows into the rivers, they get acidic and cause threat to survival of aquatic acid, aquatic life. And you can also speak about plantation, you know. So the soil, the pH of the soil is very, very important for the sustenance of the plants. You know, the pH of the soil also decides what will be the life of the particular plant species that you are planting. Okay, yeah, so I mentioned it here. So a few more points. You know, I've given you many of those. You can pick up any 4 or 5. So your pH of soil. So there is a specific range in which only few plants can grow healthily. Okay, there are few plants who can stretch this range and still survive, but that doesn't mean that they are growing healthily. Now, adding a lot of fertilizer sometimes changes this pH. Okay, and that is also very harmful. In fact, addition of pesticides also works on doing that. Again, all bodily functions generally would range from 7.0 to 7.8 in living organisms. So even our life, in fact, pH of our air around us, pH of the water that we drink, pH of the bathing water that we have, all of that is very important. So therefore, if there is a very chlorine high water, you'll find that your skin becomes very dry, because the pH of chlorine high water is very, very acidic. A very highly acidic chlorine water, chlorinated water. So when you go for swimming, for example, and then you must have heard this in daily conversations, I'm having a hair loss because my water is very acidic, and so all of that are problems of not having a good pH. Tooth decay, in fact, you should try this experiment at home, and I'm sure most of you must have seen this video. If you take your tooth and put it inside a Pepsi or a Coke for a day or two, that entire tooth will dissolve. And do you know that your teeth are the strongest organ? It has the your jaw muscles has the largest strength, if large is the right word there, in terms of the power that you can exert. Your muscles, do not really, your hand and feet muscles or other leg muscles do not have this. Your jaw muscles are the strongest in your entire body. Your teeth are very, very strong. But that entire teeth can dissolve, in pHs as close as to carbonic acid, which is about 3.5, around 3. So in Pepsi, if you put your tooth, it will dissolve in a day or two. So using toothpaste in the right way is also very important. Bee sting, or nettle sting. Nettle is another bee like insect. So it causes pain and irritation. Again, an example of knowing pH. So you use a baking soda, because bee sting is acidic, you use a baking soda to neutralize it and to get relief. Now, so we have just seen pH values. Now we'll talk about salts. Okay, what different types of salts could be present and what can be done about them. So what are salts firstly? So they are ionic compounds generally produced by neutralization between an acid and base. All of these words are important. Okay, ionic compound, they have to be ionic. Second, they are a result of neutralization between whom? Acid and base. Okay, electrically they are neutral. Electrically, there is this electrical word, which means that if you put electrodes inside of them, and if you want to just simply measure which way they sway, you'll find that most of the times they won't, even if it is between a weak acid and a strong base, like acidic or basic salt. Yeah, now there are a number of salts. Okay, so sodium chloride is one of the most common salt, we use every day in food, sodium chloride as table salt, common salt. Firstly, they are crystalline. What do you mean by crystalline? They have a definite shape and also a regular pattern of it. They have a regular pattern of it. So just for your understanding, NaCl has a very interesting pattern. Okay, it's cubical. So this is how NaCl molecule, not molecule, in fact it is one giant molecule. I hope everybody understands what is the difference between a molecule, molecular mass in fact, and a formula mass. I have said this last time or in some classes, it's formula mass actually. So there is no molecule of NaCl as such. You'll never find NaCl molecule in nature. How does it exist? It exists like Na, alternately placed. These are all Na. And then chlorine, they are placed here. Okay, so alternate chlorine. So this is Na, this will be Cl. This is again Na, this will be again Cl, again Na. So it is one giant molecule. But then why are we not writing Na 1000 and chlorine 1000? Because, these numbers also vary. These numbers also vary. Sometimes you might have that entire structure made up of one mole, 10 to the power 23 such molecules continuously arranged perfectly. Perfectly grown crystal. So in that case, what do? We just write the ratio. So we know that for every Na, I'm going to get at least one Cl. To your surprise, ZnO also behaves as a crystal. Okay. And there are many of these. There is this tellurium oxide, TO2. So here for every tellurium, twice of oxygen are present in the crystal. So you'll find that the entire crystal lattice is made up of TeNO2. which makes sure that you know the ratio between tellurium and oxide is 1:2, and therefore you will find that this is one molecule. You know, this is one way. You know that that you are able to find crystalline solids, right? So that's crystalline solids. Now, most of these salts, they generally are opaque, but they could be transparent also. Okay, so quite possible, you know, transparent salts being present. And very, very important, all of them, you know, almost 99% of them are soluble. Why? Because they are ionic in nature. If you're ionic, you will naturally be tending to be soluble. Okay, so that's solubility. Now, solution of salts does definitely conducts electricity, you know, in molten state also. Now, please note, salts do not conduct electricity only in solid state. Why? Because there is nothing to move charges. But if it is molten, generally also called as fused state, molten or fused state, both are the same words, or it is in dissolved or aqueous, okay, dissolved or aqueous state. Again, the same words, okay, they are same in meaning. You will find that they conduct electricity. Now, they could be, of course, salt will be salty in taste, they could be sour, sweet, bitter, you know, savory, multiple different tastes. Neutral salts also are odorless. Some, you know, salts can be colorless, colored, there can be different, you know, so all these variations are possible because salts themselves are formed by two basic ingredients which can be mixed in variable proportions and different types can be mixed and brought to them. Okay, here are a few types of salts. Some types of salts. So, what are these types of salts? So, neutral salts you have. So, you have a strong acid and a strong base, you know. So, neutral salt will have 7 pH. And then you have acidic salts where you have strong acid and weak base. Salt made up of strong acid and weak base. For example, here there is NH4Cl. So, NH4Cl is made from ammonia and HCl. Okay, ammonia and HCl. Or, in other words, NH4OH. Okay, NHCl will end up giving NH4Cl plus water. But please note, NH4OH is weak and HCl is strong. Now, whomsoever is the strong will be the one that will give the property to its salt. So, acidic salts are strong, are salts because they are made from the strong acid. Similarly, basic salts will be made from strong base. And if it is both, if both of them are strong, then it is basically a neutral salt. And what happens when both of them are weak? When both of them are weak. In that scenario, also please write neutral salts. Okay, there are variations in it beyond our syllabus. Okay, please write that as neutral salt. So, weak acid and weak base. If they form a salt, it will be termed as neutral salt. Okay, right. Now, another important question. Okay, there was confusion among this, and therefore, very few have been able to really say about it. So, there are family of salts. Okay, so there is an entire list of family of salts. Okay, so what do you mean by family of salts? Now, salts having common acidic or basic radicals are generally the family of salts. So, what do you mean by common acidic and basic radicals? So, let's call, for example, sodium chloride and calcium chloride. Okay, so that is CaCl2. So, called as generally the chloride family, isn't it? Now, calcium chloride and calcium sulfate will be called as calcium family. So, please note, a single salt can be a member of both the families. So it can be a member of chloride family also and calcium family also. Acha, is acidic salt and basic salt a family? No. Okay, so if you're saying acidic salts and basic salts, generally not termed as a family of salts. No, not true. So in a lot of exams, I find that when you know students are asked that please write the family of salts, they say all salts that are acidic in nature are acidic family of salts. Wrong. Basic, no. It has to deal with radicals, or in other words, ions. In simple words, ions. So the ion has to be common. Okay. So in sodium chloride, chlorine, anyone who shares chlorine, tomorrow, even if I take ZnCl2, it will be a chloride family. Okay. So this is very important. Okay. Now see, ZnCl2 and ZnSO4 is a zinc family. Okay. Now, can salts be you know, a part of more than one, more than two families? Yes. I'll give you an example. Our very own example of Na2ZnO2. This is a family of salt of sodium family, of zinc family, and also of oxide family. Sodium family, zinc family, and oxide family. So you can be a member of three different families. Okay. You know, pretty easy question. No point in losing one odd mark here. Okay, so you should definitely get a mark here. So just look at what these radicals are, and you should be able to figure out what family it really belongs to. Okay, now we are going to talk about the last six. Okay, so I'm giving almost nearly about 40 odd minutes for this. Okay, very important. And there are just the six compounds that we really are talking about. What are those? The first one is NaOH. Okay, second one is Na2CO3, NaHCO3. Okay, so sodium hydroxide, sodium carbonate, sodium bicarbonate. We will also be talking about bleaching powder CaOCl2. We'll be talking about gypsum, that is CaSO4 into water, right? So you have twice H2O and you have plaster of Paris, CaSO4 half H2, right? Both of these. And okay, are we done? Three, four. Yeah, so we have done with them, right? Four and two. Yeah, all of these are taken care, right? Sometimes we also speak a lot, a small portion about NaCl. Okay, small portion about NaCl. Now, in all of these, you will find that there are generally three very important points. So this is the list of the six compounds that you really need to remember. Okay, six or seven, you can say, with NaCl. If not with NaCl, only others are six. What are the three different points that you need to remember about them? Okay, so there are these following points that, and I've given this to you for everyone in the class also, this formula. Okay, so what is it? Firstly, you need to remember its preparation. Okay. Secondly, you need to remember either some of its chemical properties. Okay, so what they really belong to and what they can do. And lastly, you should remember their uses. You should at least remember three points in each. Okay, to make your life safe. You need to remember three points in each of these. Okay, and I'll try and show you all of these as we go forward. Sometimes I've mentioned only one or two, but I'll give you the third also as we speak. Okay, now the first point in, let's talk about sodium hydroxide. Now, in sodium hydroxide, the first point is about preparation. Now, the process is called as chloralkali. A very common question is asked is why is it called as chloralkali? The chlor word comes from chlorine, alkali word comes from alkali that is formed, which is NaOH. Obviously, you are making sodium hydroxide that has to form. So, chloralkali process comes from chlorine and NaOH. Now, this means what is, so what is the process? It is by doing electrolysis of brine water. Why don't we call it just a salt water? Brine water is 28% by weight salt dissolved in water. You don't need to remember it, just for your understanding. Brine water is a very specific concentration of salt that is dissolved in water. Okay. Whenever you take that water and you electrolyze, the ratios of the concentration of Na plus, Cl minus, H plus, OH minus, all of that is there in the water is so good that you will get maximum output of getting NaOH. Now, see how does that happen? So, your entire electrolysis diagram has to be written. I'm drawing it to you for you here. Very important. Okay. The entire electrolysis diagram has to be written. How? So you draw two electrodes. Okay. Please make sure that the connections made are correct. This is going to be anode and this is going to be cathode. So anode is here, cathode is here. Inside the solution, you have four ions, which are those Na plus, H plus, Cl minus, and OH minus. Obviously, between Na plus and H plus, Na is more reactive, so it will stay in solution. You'll recall this from chemical reactions chapter that we revised, as well as in metals and non-metals we will see. So between Na plus and H plus is going to get eliminated in the fight. And Cl minus and OH minus, Cl minus is going to get eliminated. So H plus will end up turning to the negative electrode, that is the cathode. So the cation H plus ends up going here, and the OH minus ends up going to the anode. Okay. Now this is very, very important, is that the half reactions also are something that you might need to write. There is a direct question that can come. Please write the half reactions at anode and cathode. So this is what I'm giving. Please take a note just in case if you feel that helps you. At anode, it so happens that twice of OH minus ends up giving twice of H plus. Please note, H plus is released back to the solution. Okay. One second. Not OH minus. It would be, I'm sorry. There would be chlorine coming out, right? So this is not true. Damn, I lost that. No problem. I'll just draw it one more time. Yeah. So at anode, I was saying, at anode, it is this chlorine, twice of chlorine, not twice, has to be balanced, ends up giving Cl2 plus 2e minus, quickly drawing it back. So here you had this. Okay. So this is positive, this is negative, this is anode, this is cathode, H plus going here, Cl minus going here. Okay. Na plus and OH minus staying in the solution. So at anode, chlorine goes to the anode and it ends up giving electrons to the anode, which further flows to the battery. Okay. And at cathode, the half reaction is that twice of H plus takes in two electrons and ends up giving hydrogen gas. Please note gaseous, here aqueous, all of this is very important. Okay. This is gaseous, released, arrows have to be written. Okay. Now, so chlorine gas generally, slight green or greenish in color, good to mention. Hydrogen gas pops out, good to mention. Okay. So these are the half cell reactions of sodium hydroxide. Now, what are the uses? Now, NaOH is the most commonly used base, okay, in laboratory for any titration, for any, predicting what are the compositions or concentrations of acids. In titration, you can say, okay. So it is most commonly used base in industrial processes. Basic hydrolysis for using polymerization, where you make polyethylene bags or you make cloths or you make any material, polymer material. Another important use is to make soaps. Okay, NaOH is very commonly used to make soaps. You basically do basic hydrolysis of esters. Basic hydrolysis of esters. You will be looking in carbon and its compounds chapter also. Therefore, I have not really included it here. Okay, but that's another use. So many uses. Then I have also given you a few uses at the beginning of this chapter. NaOH is also a part of lye or your cosmetics. Okay, so that's also something that we have seen at the beginning of the chapter. So that's sodium hydroxide. Now let's go to the second important component, okay, which is bleaching powder. Now, a very common question a lot of students have been asking in some textbooks, sir, it is written as CaOCl. Don't bother. Please note, this is what has been followed, and in the model answers I have checked, it is written as CaOCl2 in model answers. So go with it. This is my recommendation. The rest is your choice. What you can do is, so this is your bleaching powder. Now it is done with slaked lime. Okay. Now I have given this n number of times in my classes also, the cycle of lime. Okay. So there is quick lime. Okay. There is lime water. So I would write slaked lime before it. Okay, lime water, okay, and limestone. Okay, so limestone is CaCO3. Okay, lot of water, completely aqueous. Okay, please note, CaOH twice aqueous is lime water. Slaked lime is CaOH twice liquid. Okay, high concentration of water but not filled with water. This is a solution. Please note, this is a solution. This is a pure liquid, CaOH twice slaked lime. Okay, and quick lime is CaO. Okay, so this is the calcium cycle. You can remember the calcium cycle. You add water, you keep on drying here and keep on adding water. So you add water, you get slaked lime, you add more water, you end up getting lime water. You remove water again, you end up getting limestone. You remove more CO2, you end up getting quick lime. Remember, these important terms are used repeatedly in your syllabus. Okay, so this is the cycle of calcium, okay, calcium oxide or hydroxide. I hope you guys have taken it down. Okay, now, so calcium hydroxide, whenever it reacts with chlorine, ends up giving bleaching powder, that is CaOCl2. Okay, and this bleaching powder is used in multiple ways. See, it's basically core function now is to give back chlorine, okay, but not in the form of gas, in the form of Cl radicals. Okay, Cl radical is without a charge, which is just atoms. This Cl radicals reacts with anyone and everyone that comes in presence with it. Okay, for example, it forms HCl. If there is OH minus, it forms something called as HOCl, hypochlorous acid. Okay, anything it oxidizes, it's a very, very good oxidizing reagent. Okay, very good oxidizing reagent. What does that mean? That it oxidizes anyone and therefore it gets anyone and anything colorless. Okay. So if you basically what we do now, we have seen that bleaching action, they also bleach your skin. Why? Because if there are any pigments which are coloring the skin, the oxidation takes out those pigments. So these are not only skin, but even cloths. You have seen that, if there is, if you want to bleach something, what do we do? We want to take out the color, which is unnatural to that fabric. We do bleaching action. So the COH twice with chlorine does this bleaching action. So it's used as a disinfectant in, it's also used in swimming pools. It's used in purification of water. Now it also kills bacteria. Okay, for that matter, it also kills bacteria. Okay, sorry, one second. Yeah. Right. So bacteria and all of these all help. So I've given you four different uses of bleaching powder. One, oxidizing reagent. Disinfectant I've already given. Disinfectant in also drinking as well as swimming pool water, pool water. And I've also given you another one where it textiles. It's used in textiles to decolor things, right? So factories. Oh, textiles is already mentioned here. Factories, laundry. Yeah, fair enough. That's good enough. Okay. So there are these are a few uses. So that's one. Now let's go to the next compound, which is baking soda. Okay, another very interesting and important compound. Okay. So what is baking soda? Yeah. Now please note there is a difference between baking soda and baking powder. Okay, baking powder and baking soda are two different things, not the same. Let's talk about baking soda to begin with. So baking soda is sodium hydrogen carbonate. Okay. Now, how to make that? Okay, so there is so this process, the official name of this process is Solvay's process. Whenever I ask students what is Solvay's process, you say, sir, we don't have that in our syllabus. No. This process is called a Solvay's process. Okay. So what do? You take NaCl, you take water, you pass a lot of ammonia through it. Okay. So there is an intermediate product that is formed here, which is ammonium. Initially ammonium carbonate, NH4 twice. This further forms ammonium bicarbonate, NH4HCO3. And when this reacts with NaCl, you end up getting NaHCO3, okay, plus NH4Cl. And this NH4Cl is again reused to form NH4CO3. So the cycle keeps on going. But without getting into the details, I'm just saying sharing this because that will be additional information that can remain in your head. These compounds will reverberate in your mind and you'll be able to really remember that much more vividly. Therefore, I'm giving you these details. Okay. So what happens is NaCl, when you put with water, CO2, and ammonia, you end up getting NH4Cl and NaHCO3. Okay. Both of them is possible. Now, yeah. Right. Now, okay. Right. So now once NHCO3 is produced, this is the reaction, chemical reaction, which is also important for you. You can just simply heat it up to end up getting, sodium carbonate, which is what is, washing soda, but with water of crystallization, which we'll see in the next slide. But the point that I'm trying to make here is with just heating sodium bicarbonate, this is bicarbonate, you end up getting sodium carbonate with water and some CO2 released, of course. This CO2 produce, achha, now, in making baking powder, it is how do we make baking powder? What is the difference? Yeah, anyone is asking a question? You have a question? Okay. So how do you make baking powder? In baking powder, basically what you do is you put up a small amount of acid in it. Okay. So acid plus NaHCO3 is baking powder. I repeat one more time. Just NaHCO3 is baking soda, which ends up giving CO2 and makes dough fluffy or makes cakes and pastries, rice, all of that used in baking. But if you use NaCO3 with small amount of acid, then what happens is whatever CO2 that is coming out, it actually forms, or whatever sodium that is also coming out, it forms sodium salt of that acid. So it basically absorbs, the excess amount of, Na that is produced as well as CO2 that is given out, right? So that is used in baking powder. So that's your baking powder difference with baking soda. Now, here's I mentioned it in a lot more detail. Okay, so baking powder produces carbon dioxide on heating, so it is used in cooking. Okay, to make batter spongy. Okay, now here's the reaction. So if you only use baking soda, you end up getting CO2 out, and here's baking soda with tartaric acid, for example, which is used in tamarinds. So tamarinds have tartaric acid. you'll find that there is carbon dioxide, there is water, and there is sodium tartrate, okay, which comes in, right? So baking powder is a mixture of baking soda and a mild edible acid, okay? That is the difference. Generally tartaric acid, sometimes vinegar is also used. Vinegar is in fact quite often used, okay, very much commonly used substance with baking soda, okay. And what the mixture of these two, and acha, another important thing, this is generally used in powder form, okay. So it's just a mixture of baking soda with some powder of, so I don't know if you have seen citric acid powder, okay, so which is your lemon powder, you know, very commonly found in any of the grocery stores. So when you mix baking soda plus that is what your baking powder is formed, you know. You know, whenever you heat baking powder, you'll find that again, you know, NaCO3 is going to get decomposed. But there is a good thing that happens is that any remaining Na that is there is absorbed by the acid, okay, and therefore it helps in edible, making it more edible and not really remain unedible in consumption, okay. Now we are talking about washing soda, okay. So so what is washing soda in general? So what washing soda is, your same sodium carbonate but with water of crystallization, okay. So we'll again speak about water of crystallization in a few minutes. I'm going to define that for you and help you understand it. But just to understand it here, you know, this Na2CO3 and 10H2O, please note, do not forget writing 10H2O. Now if you actually heat this back, you know, so you have put in water, you know, and if you heat this back, you actually end up getting Na2CO3 1H2O, okay, as the beginning one. And further down, you end up getting Na2CO3 only. This is called as washing soda. This is washing soda. This is sodium carbonate monohydrate. Please note, this is called as monohydrate. And this is called as anhydrous. It's called as anhydrous sodium carbonate, or generally called as white sodium carbonate. Okay, white sodium carbonate or anhydrous sodium carbonate. What does the very word anhydrous mean? Anhydrous means something that has zero water in it, has no water in it. Okay. So this is sodium carbonate. The preparation is, you end up taking, how do you prepare sodium carbonate? You know, you prepare this from, so this is not exactly the preparation reaction, okay, this is actually the reaction of sodium carbonate. But how do you prepare is, you take NaHCO3 and you heat it, okay, you heat it very strongly. Once you heat it, you end up getting Na2CO3 to begin with, and then you add small amount of water at a controlled temperature, small amount of water at a controlled temperature. You end up getting washing soda, okay, 10H2O. So sometimes they also do, what they do is they take 1:10 mole ratio. So automatically only 10 waters are there per sodium carbonate, and your reaction stops at being washing soda and does not go beyond it. Okay. So what are the uses? So the uses are multiple. Okay, the uses of sodium carbonate. So they definitely, it is used in glass, it is used in soap, it is used in paper industry. It's also used as a cleaning agent for domestic purposes, you know, very commonly used. It is used in removal of hardness. Okay, so washing soda is one of the ways in which temporary hardness can be removed. Temporary hardness. Okay, in the last class we have seen a few glimpses on how can hardness be dealt with, whether it is temporary or permanent. Okay, so temporary hardness can definitely be removed by washing soda. Then manufacture of borax. Okay, borax is, you know, B2O3. So borax powder, okay, and different compounds of boron basically, okay, right. So all of these are very important components of washing soda, okay. Now let's look at the next compound, gypsum and plaster of Paris. Okay, we have come to the chapter and a bit early, but then we'll try and do a few more questions on these, okay. Yeah. Now let's talk about you know, water of crystallization. You know, I said Na2CO3 had water of crystallization, and it's not just Na2CO3, a lot of molecules and compounds have water of crystallization with them, okay. So what is it? It is the one that actually helps crystallize the core compound. Does that mean that the core compound cannot crystallize by itself? Sometimes no, they cannot. Without water you cannot form crystals, you know, at times. With water you definitely form better crystals, you know. So how does that really work? I'll show you a few molecular you know, things as we find time, okay. So it is the fixed number of water molecules present in one formula unit of a salt. So what do you mean by one formula unit? If you take, for example, NaCl, this is one formula unit. You take Ki, this is one formula unit. You take H2SO4, one formula unit. So you take one formula unit of CuSO4, you find out how many water come along with it. Like in the crystal, what is the ratio? Okay, what is the ratio of the water against the molecules? And from there, you are able to figure out what is the water of crystallization that you have. Okay, so CuSO4, the water of crystallization is about 5. Okay, with CuSO4 there are multiple. You know, so you in fact in CuSO4 also, you know, there are a few more. For example, there is one CuSO4 with H2O. Okay, so I don't know if you remember, pure CuSO4 is white in color. Okay, this is light blue. Okay, this is light blue. And this is sky blue. Okay, so this is, you know, very good bluish color, very very nice color, you know, very pleasant color. The CuSO4 5H2O, that coloration comes because of more of water being added to CuSO4. Now what happens to gypsum? Gypsum also contains the same water of crystallization, and it is CuSO4 twice of H2O. Whereas in when you heat this same gypsum, you end up getting less amount of water of crystallization, which is basically just half H2O. You know, this is called as POP, plaster of Paris. Okay, gypsum is actually naturally found in rocks called as dolomites. So dolomites are basically natural minerals, you know, found in, so there are a lot of these dolomite rocks you'll find especially in north India. Okay, somewhere around Punjab region and all of those regions, there are a lot of these dolomite rocks, mostly made up of calcium substances. Okay, now they would have gypsum a lot, and gypsum is like a normal mineral, you know, found in nature. You heat up this gypsum, you will find that, you know, you end up getting plaster of Paris, POP. So gypsum by itself is a bit soft. Okay, if you heat it up, you know, it hardens up, you know, to get. Now there is another very common question that a lot of students ask, sir, why is it written as CuSO4 half H2O? Why can't we write it as twice of CuSO4 and H2O? Very good, correct. Answer is absolutely right. There is no problem in writing like this. Why do we write it like this? Is because we are not studying water here, we are studying CuSO4. So we will try and make one unit of CuSO4 and then see how many units of water are clinging onto it. And we realize that it is not even a single unit, it is just half a unit, which means for every 2 units of CuSO4, I find 1 unit of water clinging around it. And therefore, I actually write CuSO4 half H2O. This is just a way of representation, because we want to stress on CuSO4 more and say that water is not that important right now. We are studying CuSO4. This is plaster of Paris. Okay. Now, plaster of Paris, there are multiple uses. You know, they are used in making toys, making decorative materials, smooth surfaces. They're also used, for example, in making sculptures. Okay. Quite commonly used in making sculptures. So how do you make sure that, you know, all of these, you know, how is plaster of Paris made? Now, is plaster of Paris, can it be brought back to gypsum? Yes, it can be. So the conversion of POP to gypsum and otherwise, one second. So the conversion of gypsum, one second. The conversion of gypsum to POP and POP to gypsum is quite possible. So you heat this and you end up getting POP, and you add water to it, you end up getting gypsum back. Okay, so these are the different ways. Now, does gypsum have a direct implication? No, I'm sorry. Gypsum doesn't have a direct application. Okay, POP has a direct application. Okay, so that's something that that really works. Okay, now, so this actually covers all of our chapter notes. Okay, but I'm going to make I'm going to give you enough time, and we are going to actually solve some previous year problems, and we will see how to write solutions for these. Okay, so here's a question for all of you, and I want you guys to attempt. So I'm going to look at everybody's answers now, and we will see how many of you are actually able to really put a answer to this. Okay, so, and please try and use all the keywords in the modern answer, in the answer that you're giving, so that I can also show you these model answers and help you diagnose whether you are able to write the right answer or not. Okay, so I have 4 questions with me, and take in your time and feel free to write your right best answer that you can do. Okay, so this is a question just asked last year. Okay, 2019. Identify the acid and base from which sodium chloride is obtained. Acid or and the base from which sodium chloride is obtained. What type of salt is it? When is it called rock salt? How is rock salt formed? What type of salt is it? When is it called rock salt and how is rock salt formed? See, this is an entire answer, absolutely information based question. No concept here, okay? It's a complete information. I mean, the only the first part is concept. And please note, it is 3 marks. So you have to give in all the keywords. You know, please go ahead and shoot your answers. I hope everybody has read this question. There are 4 parts to it. First is identify the acid base. Second, what type of salt is it? I would recommend that you give all the answer in one reply. Don't give part replies because I'll not be able to analyze with every one of you being there. So take your time, write your answer. You don't have to really make a fuss out of it. You know, just write your answer in 4 different points. Okay, point 1, point 2, point 3, and then shoot the answer. Which is the acid base used to form? What type of salt is it? When is it called rock salt? And how is rock salt formed? Let's see. Okay, so I have Vanisha's answer. You know, guys, I would just recommend, even if you've answered earlier, please make sure that you put everything in one answer and then write, because I'm going to show you a model answer and then we will be able to compare. Good, Gurman. Hita, that's right. You know, but as I mentioned, you know, try to write all the 4 parts to it. If you want to read the question once again, here it is. Which type of salt is it? When is it called rock salt? And how is rock salt formed? All of that is important.
So can you give an example of sweet salts?
Of what salts?
Sweet salt.
Sweet salt. Sweet. Oh, yeah. There are many, you know. For example, yeah. You know, your sugars, fructose and sucrose, you know, if you just slightly, you know, put them, so they have these H, you know, they have hydrogens, they have aldehydes and ketones inside them. So that aldehydic H, you know, can be put in acid. So your sugar, when you put it in, for example, tartaric acid or vinegar acid, you end up getting a acetate out of it, sugar acetates or sugar tartrates, like I showed you a few minutes ago, you know. For example, here, this is a sodium tartrate, right? So this sodium tartrate actually is tamarind, bitter in taste. It's not even salty. It's bitter in taste. Similarly, when you get sugar acetates or sugar tartrates, it's actually sweet in taste. So you have your C6, you know, your glucose, C6H12O6, you take out a few hydrogens out of it and you try and combine that with tartrates. You end up getting a mixed taste, you know, sweet and so there are, but you know, it's not as sweet as the sugar that you would taste. Okay. So you see, all of these tastes are basically a component of some ions in them. Okay. So you get the right ions, the taste can be simulated. Got your answer?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let's talk to, Sharvi has given the answer. It is called rock salt when you upgraded to crystalline form. Very good. Sharvi has mentioned this. Gokul, I could see your answer, but you know, the rock salt part is missing. Chris has mentioned rock salt part. Very good. NaOH, HCl when evaporated. Very nice. Okay, fantastic. Okay. Now, guys, I'm going to give you the answer to this. Very nice. Veda, Hita, everyone has mentioned. Yeah, Vidul. Okay, now look, I'm going to give you the solution to this and please check how many of these points did you get right. Okay, and I'm going to mark the answers for this, the model answer for this. Okay, now, so 1 mark is just for this. Okay, now, which type of a salt is this? There is a 0.5 mark. Okay, the definition when it is rock salt is 0.5 mark and this is 1 mark. Okay, so this entire thing, acid and base, is 1 mark. Which type of salt is half? This is half. Okay, when is it called half and how is the rock formed is another mark. Okay, so if you have written HCl and NaOH, which I think everybody of you have got it, you have received your 1 mark very clearly. Okay, most of you got this neutral salt very correct. Okay, so this 0.5 mark is also right. Half of you have not written one and these two parts. When is it a rock salt? Okay, So rock salt, when it is found in crystalline form, very important keyword, crystalline form like crystals, it is then mined like we mine coal. Okay, so that is rock salt. So that is the one that is found in earth, okay, bare from earth. People have written from sea evaporation. No, it has to be mined from earth, when it is found in rocks, in the rock form, like you mine coal, okay. So that's the distilled salt is not a rock salt. The second one is rock salt is formed by crystallization of sodium chloride, which is common salt, okay. The salt is darker in color because of impurities that are present in it, because of earthy components that are present in it. It is typically formed by evaporation of salty water from seawater. Okay, it can also be mined, and it's also formed from salty water. Okay, which contains dissolved Na plus and Cl minus ions. Okay, so both of this has to be mentioned. So how is rock salt formed? You evaporate, and you also have dissolved Na plus Cl minus ions with, of course, some impurities that can be done. So I think Chris mentioned that. Chris has mentioned that, which is right, which is okay. Okay, now, yeah, here we are. Okay, Sharvi has also mentioned. Fantastic. Okay, so all those who are able to do this, very nice. Okay, let's go to the next question. Now you know the pattern. Please try and write all the points. There is another 3-marker question. You would need about a minimum of 4 to, yeah, this would have 4 points a minimum. Okay. So 2 mL of sodium hydroxide solution is added to few pieces of granulated zinc metal taken in a test tube. When the contents are warmed, a gas evolves, which is, so there is a gas, okay, which is bubbled through a soap solution for testing. Soap solution. Write the equation of the chemical reaction involved. So we need to write, first thing is that we need to write the equation. The second thing is name the gas. So we need to identify the gas. The last one is which will be evolved when the same metal reacts with dilute solution of a strong acid. So gas when it reacts with dilute solution of strong acid. Okay. So this were 3 marks. Let me see. Yeah, so the equation itself, I'm sure, would be about 1.5 marks. Gas would be about half a mark. No, hang on. Name the gas which is evolved when X with delta. No, gas would be about one. This would be about 1 mark, and this I think is about 2 marks. Yeah, let me just quickly check. Yeah, that's right. So this is given for 2 marks, and this is given for 1 mark. Correct. Yeah. So take your time. As I mentioned, write the entire answer in one go. Please do not write in split parts, because then we are not able to analyze it. Okay, no answers yet. Yeah, I have Veda's answer. Vanisha's answer I have. Good. So, ta-da. That's nice. Vanisha, I think you are there. Gurman, okay. Yeah, here it is. Yeah, take your minute. Take your minute and
Thanks a lot,
sure.
sir.
Take your minute and try and write the answer completely. I'll comment on everybody's answer. Don't worry. Okay. I guess that's good time. Let me see. Okay, very nice. So I have, where was I? I was at, oh, very nice. I was at Manisha's answer, and then I have, yeah, Vanisha, your answer is pretty there. Tanishka's answer, yeah, Tanishka, some more points. I think you have mentioned it down below. Okay, Sharvi's answer, pretty much there. Gurman, okay, Gurman has used the shortcut. Okay, Veda is, yeah, okay, done. Yeah, Splinter, okay, Sharvi, fair enough. Tanishka, yeah, the half part is there. Charan Akash, zinc reacts with sodium hydroxide and gives sodium zincate. Okay, and to Shanmukh, very nice, Shanmukh. I think you are there. Very good, Veda. Fair enough. Okay, very nice. I think most of you have been able to do that. One quick pointers, okay? People have not balanced this. I understand probably you're typing, therefore you're not balancing. That's okay. But important point, Veda has balanced. Yeah, and even I think Vanisha had also balanced. Neha is not yet balanced, but that's okay. I know that that's not an error on your part, but important point that I'm mentioning. Rest all seems to be good. Okay. Yeah. Great. Yeah. Now let's look at the model answer. So I've also got your model answer for you here. Check this. Okay. So the entire thing is important. So what are the parts that needs to come out very clearly? One second. Here we are. Okay. Yeah. So look. Solid, aqueous, balance, arrow, everything is important. This entire thing will basically give you 1.5 marks. Pop sound gives another half mark. Okay. The test involved, pop sound is going to give you half a mark. Okay. That's what is there. So I'm going through the model answer and giving you this. So there you get 2 marks. And then this equation is important. Okay. So this has been written in the, so just naming the gas is not, so see, although they have asked this, name the gas which will be evolved when some same metal reacts with dilute strong acid, there is no need. They have not asked you this equation, but to your surprise, they have given this in the model answer. So if you don't write this, you're going to lose half a mark. Okay. And this is for another half a mark. Okay. So 1.5 for this reaction, half a mark for pop sound. They have given half a mark for writing the equation. Although that is not asked, please note, there is nowhere written. They have only said name the gas which will be evolved with dilute reaction. They have not said state the reaction. But not writing a reaction, you will end up losing half a mark, unfortunately. So that's how, you know, CBSE is. So you better be ready, better be, you know, proactive at your end and make sure that you are addressing the all the points that they are desiring. Okay. Okay. Now we have 2 more questions to go. So I'm going to give it slightly faster. Okay. Now that you are well versed, please attempt this in the next 2 minutes. You know, we don't have much time also left. So there is this 2 marker. It's a 2 marker question. Try and attempt in your best. I'm going to keep this screen for a few seconds and then we will be looking at the solution. Yeah. Let's see. Okay. So what is observed when 2 mL of dilute hydrochloric acid is added to 1 gram? Okay, 2 mL, 1 gram of sodium carbonate, dilute hydrochloric acid, taken in a clean dry test tube. Write chemical equation for the reaction. Now, please note, they have said what is observed. This is going to carry 1 mark. And then writing chemical equation is going to carry 1 mark. So you better be, now I understand that you might not be able to type the entire thing. I take it. I know it. But try and give your best is all I'm saying. Try and give your best is all I'm saying. Okay. So if you have read this question well, I hope if you have taken down, I've already said what is observed has to be written pretty well. Writing the chemical equation has to be written pretty well, clearly. It's a 2 marker question asked last year. Just last year, this question was asked. Let me see how many of you are able to write this. Okay, now, very nice. So I'm going to go from the bottom. Veda has written it. She has balanced it also. She's written gas plus. Okay, I just said something about this particular test. I said something about this particular test. Sodium carbonate, okay. Tricky one, okay. Okay, so Sharvi has written, that's right, Sharvi. Fantastic, okay, good balancing. I think you would do in the paper. Veda, balancing is done. That is also done, nice. Gurman, very well, okay. Yeah, fair enough, yeah. Yeah, that's right, Madhumita. Fantastic. Yeah, Medha has also been able to try, has been able to write this. Very nice. So, excellent when excess CO2 is added. Very good, very good, very good. Yeah, fantastic. So, Gokul has also mentioned this. So, Gokul, Veda, Sharvi. Okay, excellent. Okay. Yeah, fair enough. Tanishka. Okay. Okay, Gurman, Charanakash, you know, as I mentioned, you know, you the entire writing, Madhumita, very nice, very good, very good. I think everybody is able to do this now. Okay, okay. So I'm going to show you this model answer and I'm going to make a few comments which are important for understanding this. Okay, please note, please make a note of this. Okay, yeah, so let me show you the answer first. Okay, here's the model answer. Oh, sorry. Yeah, here's the model answer. On diluting HCl with Na2CO3, okay, which is what we are looking at. So HCl was put in Na2CO3 in a clean, a brisk effervescence. Okay, so this effervescence word has been used in model answer. Please note, effervescence word has been used in model answers. Okay, CO2 released is not sufficient. CO2 gas is released, not sufficient. Bubbling is an alternative word that they have given here. Okay, so as I am seeing at the model answer, effervescence slash bubbling, okay, slash bubbling, gas released also they have mentioned, gas they have mentioned, so probably you will get this, but CO2 is of little significance at this point, you know. So this is for one mark, okay, just the observation due to evolution of CO2 gas, and then the reaction twice of HCl. Here it has to be mentioned aqueous Na2CO3 aqueous. I was not able to type in here, therefore I have left that. Okay. Ends up giving H2O liquid, CO2 arrow gaseous. All of that will fetch you another one mark. Okay, so brisk effervescence, bubbling of gas, gas released, all of these is important. And then writing the chemical reaction. Twice HCl, Na2CO3, H2O, CO2, you know, balancing. Balancing is another important bit. H2O, CO2 are already balanced. NaCl should be added here. Okay, NaCl. Yeah, twice of NaCl plus H2O plus CO2. All of that, and NaCl will be aqueous. So all of this will get you your complete two marks. Okay, okay. Now let's go to the last question that I wanted to show you today. Okay, let's do a quick last one. Oh, do I have one? I don't. Okay. Right. Good. I do have one. Okay. So I'm going to give you one more. Let me see. Okay, so give me one quick minute and I'm going to give you one quick question. Hang on, guys, give me a minute. Yeah, here's a question for you. I'm going to dictate it. Okay, guys, please note and try and write the answer for this. So this is a question that was asked in 2018 itself again. Okay, three marker. I'm going to dictate this question. Please write an answer to this. The pH of a salt used to make tasty and crispy pakoras. Okay, so common Hindi word used. So guys who doesn't know pakoras might have missed out on this question. The pH of a salt used to make tasty and crispy pakoras is 14. Identify the salt and write a chemical equation for its formation. Identify the salt and write a chemical equation for its formation. That is the first one. The second one is list its two uses. List its two uses. I'm going to repeat one more time. pH of a salt to make tasty and crispy pakoras is 14, 1-4, 1-4. pH is given to us. identify the salt and write a chemical equation for its formation. Okay, so I'm going to reshare the screen and probably, yeah, I'm going to reshare the screen. Give me a second. Why can I not reshare? Yeah, Akash, because I stopped sharing. Here's the screen. I'm going to write that question for you, and then I'm going to give the model answer also here itself. Okay. Okay. So pH to make pakoras, okay, is 14 of a salt. Okay, pH of a salt is given to you. They have asked you identify the salt. Identify the salt. Let me see if I can put it on the screen for you. Yeah. Yeah, I am able to put it in the screen. Oh, come on. Yeah, here it is. Okay. Try and answer this. List its two uses. It's a two marker, so take your time and put all the points that are important for this. Okay, identify the salt and write a chemical equation for its formation. List its two uses. Let's see how many of you are able to do that now. Okay, I hope everybody's got this. Okay. Uses. Very good, Gurman. See, that is very important. See, he is the first, I think. I don't know if anyone has given it earlier or not. So Gurman and Gokul. Achha, Gokul has also given now. Very nice. Guys, yeah, Medha has also given. Very good. Okay. So without giving the equation, you know, you will not get your full mark. Without giving the equation, not getting full mark. Yeah. So Veda, Vanisha has also given now. Okay. Very good. Now everybody is trying, is giving it up. Okay. That is very important. So, yeah. Yeah. Very good, Charan. Akash. Excellent. So Shanmukh has also given it. It is also balanced in some ways. Okay, fair enough. Okay, yeah, lot of answers varying a bit. Okay, from each other, but I think most of you have been there. Okay, most of you have been there. So I'm going to give you the model answer for this. Okay, so please note the important valuable points. The first thing that they have said in the model answer here is the salt is. Yeah, so they have given it as NaHCO3. Okay, NaHCO3. Please note it is not Na2CO3. For God's sake, it is not Na2CO3. It is NaHCO3 has been given here. Okay, and they have also given this reaction NaHCO3. Okay, heating is giving out Na2CO3 plus H2O plus CO2. Okay. Twice. So this has been released. Okay. This has been given. Okay. Yeah. So this is mentioned, and write a chemical equation for its formation. So this is mentioned for use. Now for formation, they have used this NaCl equation. Okay. So if you have given Na2, I can see a lot of you have been giving. It will be okay. Yeah. So a lot of you have actually written everything around. Yeah. So Shanmukh's reaction is right, which I can see also correct with Charvi and all the others. So you have been able to write this reaction of formation pretty well. Yeah. pH 14 is, I know the pH is slightly misleading, guys. I understand. but it is NaHCO3 that they have mentioned. So therefore, I'm rechecking and giving you the mod, you know, the one that has been mentioned here. Okay. So here they have clearly mentioned. Okay. So giving you one more time. Okay. NaHCO3 stands for half a mark. Okay. They have also written here the equation where twice of NaHCO3 ends up giving Na2CO3 plus H2O plus CO2. Okay. And this leads to crispiness. Okay, this leads to crispiness. This is what has been mentioned. So I guess, but you know, they have not given, strangely, they have not given any mark here, but I assume that, you know, probably this is another half a mark. Okay. Or else just NaCO3 would lead you to one mark, but this has been mentioned in the answer. So better be clear about it. Now, the second thing, it's formation reaction, you know, preparation or formation. That reaction has been written as NaCl plus NH3 plus H2O plus CO2. Ends up forming NaHCO3 plus NH4Cl. Okay, NaHCO3 plus NH4Cl. Is it balanced? Is it balanced OH plus H2O? Is it? No. Not it balanced. Yeah, I'm sorry, yeah. Yeah, Medha. I know, it's right, you know. So Medha, I connect to you, but I can't help, you know. I mean, that's what has been there. So that's why I've always been saying, especially in chemistry and biology, this is the case. Okay, it is not the case in physics and for example, maths. You know, in maths and physics, you would get point to point answers, but here they have. Okay, here they have mentioned. So it's better to really use it. Sharvi, that's not the reaction for preparation. So Vanisha's reaction is right. NaCO3 plus Na2CO3 plus NH4Cl. But I'm going to go get you back to the model one. You know, so for example, here where we just wrote this. Yeah, NaCl plus H2O plus CO2 gives NH4Cl plus NaHCO3. That's the one. That's all we need. Okay, this reaction. I hope everybody is able to get this. Okay. So this reaction has been asked for a mark. Okay, so this is what you have to reproduce for another mark. Okay, look at the reaction. You know, small things here and there can take you completely off the grid. Okay, and list two of its uses. I think this everybody has got it right. I'm going to give you four or five uses to this. So the first use, of course, is using in making baking powder or in baking purely. You know, making food fluffy. CO2, making dough, rice, all of that. Okay. Second, very much used in making cleansing action also. Okay, it is very much used in cleansing action. Okay, used as antacids. Okay, used in textiles. Okay, textiles also. So all of this, you know, multiple of this. Any two is useful. Antacids is very good. Baking is very good. I think everybody remembers these two. Okay, good. So, great. Sagar, unfortunately, there is no choice. So you need to do chemistry as well. Okay. Yeah, fantastic. Very nice. Good. So, good session. You know, I like being on these sessions. I don't know how you guys feel. A quick comment, you know, does this really help you guys? You know, how is it really happening? How does it all go for you guys? How these sessions go? Can you quickly put in, are they helping you? Do you feel, kind of, really, I mean, something that adds value to you. Okay, so Shreyas is enjoying it, Vanisha is enjoying it. But you know, guys, you don't have to be just goody-goody about it all the time. You know, you can very clearly please mention. In fact, I would like to hear anything that we can improve upon, you know, but because that helps everyone to assimilate things. Okay, anything that you feel that we can add more to that can actually help you guys. Oh, last class of the decade. Yes, Charan, that is right. Okay, anyone who feels that there is anything that we can add to what we have been doing that, you know, that can make. Yes, you know, Veda, that feature will come in soon. So the comment box will be floating at my end. In fact, on our Zooms, it always floats. We have much more power, but because now we are using Moxtra, it will come up soon. Okay, Chirish. Yeah, missing you, man. I hope we'll meet up soon. Good. Yeah, that's nice, Prisha. Yeah, okay, Prisha. Yeah, I know that. Audio quality. Charan, you know, mostly it might be a function of your internet also, yeah. You know, not really always a function in here. But Veda, yes, of course. The entire next year we are going to have classes. The very next week we'll have classes. So okay, good. In fact, you know, guys, you know the good part about this is that right now I'm in Pune actually, you know, and I'm able to connect to all of you. And I think it is pretty seamless, you know. So in spite of me not really being there, you know, we are able to meet and talk, okay, pretty nicely. So it's like 30th, I'm still working, but I'm so happy that I am able to close the class session with you guys for this year, which is a really nice thing. You know, so pretty nice to see all of you, meet all of you, know all of you. I know a few of those mischievous faces and names, at the same time a few glad ones. So good to have all of you together. Okay, very nice, guys. So thank you so much. I know that you know you guys will keep on being. So yes, yeah, so you guys have a good time wherever you are. Bye bye.